Hey everyone, it's Norm from Tested and welcome back to Projections. But this week we're not talking about a virtual reality or mixed reality headset. We're actually talking about a different type of projection, a holographic display. So this is the Looking Glass Portrait. And earlier, the very beginning of this year, I had the chance to preview this device, early prototype of it, and now it started shipping to their Kickstarter backers. This one actually is on loan from our very own Jeremy Williams, who is one of their earliest backers, and I've had a chance to spend a couple weeks with it because it is a device that endlessly fascinates me. And you might have seen some video of it go viral recently playing volumetric Doom on this device. In case you're unfamiliar, this is made by a company called Looking Glass Factory, and the engineers and really the futurists over there over the past 10 years have tried to find ways to create a volumetric display. They started off with kind of the 3D matrix of LED lights. They've done everything from things encased in acrylic to this now more refined device that isn't just for developers, but what I really think is makes sense for early adopters and tech enthusiasts. And I've been having a ton of fun with it. So as you can see, it's a display, you know, it looks like a digital picture frame, and in some senses, it's kind of that. Also works as almost like an external monitor you can plug into a computer. But unlike your typical LCD display or small screen or tablet or whatever, this is a light field volumetric display. And that it sounds very fancy, but you can almost think of it as like one of those old lenticular book covers where you see that classic, you know, a lenticular screen, and if you hold that book or that sheet in front of you and move your head, you either see an image that's in three dimensions, or you might, as you move your head, you see some movement. And the idea behind that is that screen, which has that iconic kind of vertical lines, that striping, is a filter that then takes the backing, the print of whatever that was, and splits it into different views. So where your relation to it, your left eye and your right eye would see different parts of the image. And when at an appropriate distance, at a certain sweet spot, your left and right eye would see maybe a stereo image. Stereo would be in 3D. Or as you move your head around, it would shift from the different interlaced pictures to create the illusion of movement. And that's essentially what's kind of happening here. There is a lenticular filter, a screen, on top of, instead of a printed sheet, it is an active display. And so it's lit up. And this thing is self-contained. So right now I just have it plugged into USB-C for power, and it's running off of a built-in Raspberry Pi. And as I'm cycling through these preloaded images, I'll try to give you a sense of that depth. And you can see as I rotate this left and right, here's an example of the field of view, right? There's a sweet spot for sure, but as you move your head around, in this case, the camera lens here, you can see that there's not only depth, there's parallax. It looks like there is a 3D object inside this screen. Not only does it go deep, look like the illusion, it goes beyond the screen, but it looks like it pops out a little bit as well. And the idea is that they're displaying up to a 100 different viewpoints all at once. In fact, here it looks like based on the source images, there's a sweet spot of about 48 different views, 6x8. And the source images here are basically displaying 48 different interpretations of this scene all at the same time along a horizontal axis. So you can think of that old, like when they made The Matrix, they had the bullet time cameras, all those DSLRs along a row and took those pictures all at once. This is displaying 48 pictures all at once. Your eyes may only get, you know, half dozen or so of those, but as you move your head around, you're seeing different parts of the scene. And because it's taking a standard LCD screen and splitting up into those views and going through a filter, you know, resolution-wise, it's not as maybe as crisp as you'd find on like a retina display or something, but it's still sharp enough that it's very visible. There's no text here, but for faces, for 3D models, for even little rendered scenes, it looks vibrant and crisp. And it doesn't have any of that ghosting that you might see as a hallmark of those old lenticular screens. They're doing some interesting blurring as they render out these images. Now, these are all pre-rendered. So as I cycle through them, you know, they might look like 3D rendered scenes, right? But what they really are pre-rendered outputs. And basically think of it like a digital picture frame. You're taking some type of asset, whether it's a pre-rendered scene or photo, and then sideloading it onto this device from your computer. And then this can store hundreds and hundreds of those images, which I can cycle through by pressing these buttons on the side. I can pause it one, and I can even adjust this ring light that goes around the outside. That light helps give more of an illusion of depth because the sides of the display are mirrored. And so it has like a framing effect where it looks like there's like a lit almost cube or some type of grid that the 3D image, the volumetric image is living within. And it's super neat, the images that come out of the box, incredibly compelling. And it's a mix of rendered things and also very powerfully, notably, also photos taken with a standard smartphone. Because phones these days, your iPhone, your Android phone, not only can they take a nice high resolution picture, they can also take a depth map. That's how Apple would do its portrait mode and can blur out the background. It's using depth data, whether it's from like a LiDAR sensor or multiple cameras, to add an extra layer of information on top of the photo so that it can say that it can recognize that part of the image, whether it's someone's face, maybe in the foreground and some part is in the background. And that's maybe the coolest part of the Looking Glass portrait. And the thing I was most curious about, what is that workflow to get a photo off of your phone? You know, all those portrait photos that you may have taken, not only with this phone, but phones over the past couple years, starting with like the iPhone X. What can you do with those photos? How long does it take to process that and get that onto the Looking Glass portrait? That was what I was able to explore. That's what I want to share with you today. So let's head over down to my desktop PC, plug this into USB for data and HDMI onto my computer, and I'll run you through the software, including Doom. All right, so what I have lit up here is the Holoplay Studio application. They have a version of this for Windows and Mac, and you install a service that recognizes the Looking Glass portrait. And this is how you would add what they call a hologram to the Looking Glass. So I've already done some preloaded ones, but basically you go to click add hologram, and you have the option of adding an iPhone portrait photo, or you could take a bunch of sequential images, almost like that Matrix bullet time camera array, but we'll do just an iPhone portrait photo. We're gonna import, and I've just downloaded these JPEGs off of my iCloud, so let's do that one, and now it's loaded. So what you actually see on the Looking Glass right now, which I can see as well, is the photo we've loaded. And essentially there's a depth map that they've converted into a 3D model. So my son here is in the foreground and it basically looks like almost like a texture wrap. They've taken the photo and wrapped it around their modeling, a 3D model of the same image using that depth map. And I can adjust some settings here for what they call the depthiness. So flatten out that image here, as you can see, or stretch it back. And it's essentially a 3D model at this point with some dynamic attributes I'm adjusting. So like how deep do I want the scene to be? And I want it really deep. Then where do I want the focus point to be? There's like a sweet spot, a plane where there's a spot of focus. So too far up front and the convergence doesn't really work, too far back and it gets a little blurry, but right a sweet point right here. Super easy to do with these. And then you also have the ability to, you know, toggle inverting the depth, which is really weird, or the depth position. But at that point, this image is ready to be uploaded to the display. And when this gets exported to a format that then the Looking Glass itself can read, it's really interesting. I'll pull an example of one up right now. It's actually what they call a quilt format. And here's an example of that. This is an animated video, but you see this grid of 8x6, 48 different views. When I was talking about that lenticular display, that's what I'm talking about here. These 48 different views are all displayed at the same time in the display here. And then if you move your head left to right, you actually can see, you know, behind a little bit. You get some parallax. The text is in the front. And there's more you can do with these iPhone portrait photos as well. There's a piece of software that Looking Glass has called Diorama, and you can import an image. So I will load another depth photo, and you can then actually add elements to it. So, and then what's cool is I can actually move my mouse all the way across, because this actually acts as a third screen, and I can manipulate this in real time. So it's taking this photo of our dog, which is another depth map, and adding elements like these funky lights, but I can adjust and I can do things like change the background if I want to do a more crazy background. Let's see what that looks like. And these backgrounds, all these assets are just pulled in from Jiffy, so I can actually, you know, do something like search San Francisco and pull in, here, let's add this to the scene, or maybe this one. This one's not bad. And again, I can also go back into Looking Glass itself and not only adjust the image here, but move my head physically around this display to see what that parallax looks like. Let's go add some stickers. Let's see. There you go. How about another little Boston Terrier right here? I can even adjust the depth of this. Bring it to the foreground, shrink it to the background. And then also adjust the lighting. And you can actually see that shadowing behind. What's neat is I can actually click these lights and dynamically move it around. Basically, it's a 3D scene here. Like, again, taking that portrait image and turning it into a model that's texture map. And then when I'm ready, then I click record video, and then it'll start rendering out all of those views. And with every frame here, there's gonna be 48 different angles so that this can display them all at once. Next up, beyond the scope of just the images, there's also objects that I can load in, OBJs. And they have some sample ones here. So this is a 3D model, it's textured, and you can see on the flat screen here, I can do a little bit of manipulation of it. And as I do that, it's actually rendering out, again, all of those views on the Looking Glass, so I can actually look around this robot and see it as if it's floating right here in front of the display. Here's another example of a sample robot. And as I manipulate this, it's kind of animating right there on the display. I can adjust some settings and change the shader effects, adjust the detail, the brightness, even the lighting. I can actually move that lighting around, which is really neat. You can see if I move this backdrop behind, then I can dynamically adjust that lighting. And if you 3D print files, so you're used to STLs, you can use a program like Mesh Mixer and export those as OBJs without textures, and then load them in, and it becomes a really, really high mesh model that I can see in full 3D on the Looking Glass.
once again, I can take a screenshot here, or I can record a video and basically flatten out this particular animation or this view, and then get it something I can just look at baked into a quilt image that they have. And then finally, here is Doom playing on the Looking Glass, which is just a Unity version of Doom running the Looking Glass API. So then creates a lenticular screen, and you can see that looks like Doom. And what's really cool here is you can actually look around the scene. So as I'm moving around, you can actually look around the corner.
So after going through that software and even running a game like Doom, a very recognizable game, but being able to do things like look around the pillars and actually play it in a new and novel way, my big takeaway so far with this is not only have they created a nicely packaged piece of hardware that has this sweet spot in terms of it running right out of the box, already compelling that way, but also a software package that's feels refined as well. The workflow to get photos and dress them up in those dioramas and get them onto the device is really simple. Now, it does require a little bit of processing power, and my desktop was much more capable at doing those type of renders than my laptop, especially the real-time OBJ viewer, but it's doable. And maybe there'll be efficiencies in the software, because my hope is to maybe run this in a self-contained compute box, like one of those Intel NUCs, and be able to do view OBJs and in a self-contained way without having to plug into a big desktop PC. And in terms of games, while Doom is certainly eye-catching and a real wow moment for anyone who's played Doom before, I'm really more excited about the other potential game opportunities for the Looking Glass Portrait with the Unity plugin and then Unreal plugin and developers making, you know, isometric games and vertical shooters. You know, classic games like Galaga could look really cool in a volumetric way, and it feels like we're just getting started with this. So we'll be doing more coverage of the Looking Glass Portrait when I get my backer unit in, because I really want to try out like Kinect video conferencing with a volumetric video, and also as they drop more of their holograms and more software is released for it. If you have questions about this, feel free to post in the comments below, but it is still available for that backer price of $250. And I think if you're an early adopter in tech, this is a safe bet because it's something that works and you can take advantage of right now with all the photos you've taken on your phone. I want to thank Jeremy for letting me borrow his early unit to check out and go hands-on with, and I will see you next time.